Hello everyone, I hope you are doing well. Welcome to the 100th lecture. If you have watched my 99th video that was released last Saturday, you may have a better idea about my channel and my motivation to work on this channel. If you haven't watched it already, the link is in the description. According to my video releasing schedule, today's video is supposed to be a monthly Q&A. However, since it is the 100th video, I'd like to add two more topics besides the monthly Q&A. In today's video, I will mainly focus on three aspects. First, I would like to announce a new non-profit organization that I'm working on for the community. Second, I would like to introduce the practice system that I have been working on for the last 10 years. And then I will answer some questions asked by the community members. Let us have a quick look at the questions for today. First, Frank Blaney, Xing Yi versus Tai Chi in one's 50s. Second, Ernesto Pong, Nei Gong versus Qi Gong versus Daoyin in Daoist and Shaolin context. Three, WahrerDrache combo drills in Xing Yi. Fourth, Thomas Hudecsek, responding to people with wrong yet strong opinions. Fifth, from Eric Potter. First, clarification. Did Zhou Bu Li Lei have an even longer version than the five-sentence proverb in Xing Yi Quan Quan Pu? Sixth, Eric Potter. Clarification. Was the name Xing Yi coined only in the 1930s? Seventh, Eric Potter. Clarification. Does Jin Sui Shen really means tightly following the body? So, without any further ado, let's get started. Today, on the occasion of the 100th video, I'm happy to announce a new non-profit organization, Daoist Arts Organization International, or DAOI. DAOI is an acronym. DAOI also approximately sounds like Daoist Arts in Chinese language. In the beginning of this year, I got this non-profit organization registered in order to have a better way to promote the traditional internal martial art and Xiudao practice. Actually, I have had this plan for a very long time, but without help, it is just impossible for me to do it. Fortunately, with some of my students and friends, the registration process has finished, and it's time to announce it. This organization will aim to promote Daoist and other traditional-based arts, including martial arts, Xiudao, and traditional Chinese medicine by creating a community bound by a non-partisan objective standard of practice. We will strive for universal access to the basic and useful tools needed to start and improve the practice of those arts and keep learning authentically. We will have an online magazine and organize different community-based activities to better promote those arts that we passionately love through both online and offline platforms. Right now, I'm working on creating the website and it should be done pretty soon. I hope you have a basic idea of this new organization. Again, this organization belongs to the whole community, and you are a part of it. To make it happen, I need your support and involvement. I believe with your engagement, this organization will benefit all of us and future generations. Now, let's come to our second main topic for today. On the occasion of this 100th video, I would like to introduce the practice system that I have been working on for the last 10 years. In the 99th video, I talked about what I believe in the traditional way of practice. Based on that thought and approach, I have created a knowledge and a practice structure in order to help practitioners understand the system better. Today, I'd like to use this special opportunity to share it with you. At the same time, I'm also keeping an open-minded attitude in dealing with your suggestions and recommendations. I'd like to hear your thoughts on it. I will appreciate any feedback you provide, and I will take it into serious consideration. So please do not hesitate to let me know. After years of practice, teaching, and research, I have realized that the traditional Chinese internal practice should have important building blocks, including both martial art practice and Xiudao practice. Also, there are even more elements that should be included in the traditional system, even though some of the specific practice may not be that old. With these factors in mind, I have created the knowledge and the practice structure, which you will see here. The objective of this method is to organize the different theory, concept, knowledge, practice, and application of them is to systematically introduce each element of the structure so that many abstract topics will become comprehensible and less intangible. As a result, practitioners will know what and how to follow in their practice. It is more of a process of organization than a process of simplification. So, it is a three-level structure reflecting their interrelationships. The foundation level is the ancient Chinese philosophy system. The second level is the three-pillar system. Then, third or the top level is the philosophical system built upon the previous two levels. Now, let me briefly explain them one by one. The first level is the foundation level, which consists of the most important ancient Chinese philosophy system. We all know that many practices, especially Chinese practice, are often built on philosophical foundations. There have been many different philosophical systems that have been developed in the last few millennia. And I have to say that even though all of them are equally important in terms of helping us understand ourselves, our society, and the universe, Daoism and Confucianism are the two main philosophical systems that have had the most profound impact on the development of the internal styles of practice in all the different aspects. So, understanding the fundamentals of each of these systems will help a practitioner build a strong foundation for further practice. The second level consists of the three-pillar structure of specific practice. Each pillar implies a specific area of practice. The first pillar stands for the three styles of internal martial arts. The second pillar stands for energy practice, which include both Xiudao and Qigong. Last but not least, the third pillar stands for traditional Chinese medicine, which includes but isn't limited to herbal medicine, acupuncture, and Tuina. Even though there are overlapping areas among those three practices in terms of their benefits, each of them has a unique benefit or more advantageous functions compared to the others. In other words, each pillar can be used to serve more specific benefits. Since each pillar has a specific benefit and objective of a practice, which has been briefly mentioned in my prior videos, I'd like to briefly reiterate them here. The fourth pillar consists of three internal styles of martial arts, including Xing Yi, Ba Gua, and Tai Chi. Even though different branches of each of the three styles may differ from each other, overall, they share the same characteristics and provide similar benefits. The objective is mainly self-defense, but of course, they can also be practiced for health and other purposes. I have videos introducing each of them in building block format. Links are in the description. The second pillar consists of energy-related practice, including both Xiu Dao and Qi Gong. I'd like to point out that Xiu Dao has a much deeper and more profound impact on one's energy level. It is the core of Dao's practice. Qi Gong can be considered a much more simplified Xiu Dao practice with a more dynamic approach. They may offer similar benefits in the beginning, but with time, Xiu Dao can provide many more benefits. This is the second pillar which focuses on energetic practice. Finally, the third pillar focuses more on a natural healing benefit compared to the other two pillars, even though both of them can provide a great deal of healing function by themselves. Traditional Chinese medicine, or TCM, is the more natural way of healing compared to modern medicine. TCM practice can be easily integrated into anyone's existing lifestyle. TCM is the more holistic approach to health maintenance, a solution that has been applied for thousands of years and has been modernized in the last few decades. Academic TCM study may take you years of training in university in China in order to practice it in a hospital. Ideally, one would be able to study the whole program in a TCM university, but anyone can master a fundamental knowledge of TCM and make it work for themselves if they do not have the time or the energy or the inclination to fully engage in a full TCM degree program. Again, this three-pillar approach is a structured system that integrates the three important Chinese traditional practices together in a synergistic way in order to elevate our practice into a new level. I created this three-pillar structure based on not only my personal training experience, but also on the research result of prominent figures in history. Of course, it is very rare to see one person who has studied all of these areas of knowledge. It still can be a valuable and practical guideline for you to set up a higher goal in pursuing a better level in practice. Please, do not get discouraged when you see this structure. Our life is long enough to learn as much as we can, no matter our current situation. Also, the three-pillar illustration does not imply that all three aspects have to be studied with equal importance. It's the collective knowledge and the practice of these three aspects based on your objective that matters in the end. Let me quote Mahatma Gandhi's proverb again. Live as if you were to die tomorrow. Learn as if you were to live forever. Now, let me introduce the third level of the structure, which is the philosophical system built upon the previous two levels. I believe that the richness of Chinese philosophy can have a major impact not only on our practice, but also, and more importantly, on our daily lives. Especially when we treat martial art and Xiu Dao practice as part of life. Extracting the essence from those ancient philosophies and integrating them in our practice is the main goal of the third and final level. I have been working on it for years and I'm continuously improving it. I will elaborate on this level in more detail in the near future. You can see that this structured system is not the single static one. It is the dynamic ongoing system that covers the major parts of the traditional practice in our modern time. Based on my personal learning, training, teaching, and recent experience, I'm working on not only the construction of the system, but also on deepening the knowledge and the practice for each element of the system. Like I just mentioned, I have been working on it for more than 10 years now, and I'd like to share the concept with you today. You may say this is a huge project, and of course, you would be right. But I plan to work on it ceaselessly. Continuous improvement with time will only make the content richer, the concept stronger, and the benefit better. So, that was a brief introduction of the practice system that I have been working on for years. Gradually, I will elaborate more in the future. Now, let me answer some of the questions asked by our community members. Frank Blaney asks, for a fit person in their late 50s with a strong martial art background, Jiu-Jitsu, do you think it is better to focus on Xing Yi or Chen Tai Chi for self-defense and health? Frank, thank you for the question. Well, 50s is a very young age, and I'm in my 50s too. As for choosing between Xing Yi and Tai Chi in your 50s, based on my teaching experience, I will say it depends on your own learning habits. If you prefer simple movements that are very practical in self-defense, Xing Yi is a better choice. If you like to learn many movements but focus more on health maintenance than on self-defense, then Chen style Tai Chi is a very good choice. Each style can provide specific benefits compared to others. A few factors should be taken into consideration while deciding a style to practice. I have a video titled Which Style to Choose? Constructing Xing Yi Ba Gua Tai Chi No. 9. Link is in the description. Please have a look if you haven't already. Frank, I'm sure that video will answer your question better. Now, let's move on to the next question. Ernesto Pong asks, I would like to ask a question on a topic I'm still confusing about. This is the difference among the terms 内功, 气功, and 导演. Also, is there a difference between 内功 and 气功 in the Daoist and the Shaolin context? Thank you. Thank you, Ernesto. Yes, this is a common topic that confuses many people, so let's sort it out today. First, let's talk about 内功. 内功 means internal practice. So, traditionally, 内功 can be used to express any energy-related practice that aims to improve the practitioner's energy level. As for the term energy, it can be the energy used in Xiudao, or it can mean energy used in martial art practice. For the last few decades, 内功 is almost exclusively used in martial art practice, even though it was earlier used in Xiudao and Qigong practice too. Now, let's talk about Qigong. Qigong is a term that is commonly known as an exercise to improve health through physical movements, breathing, and meditative activities. Qigong and Neigong have not been concretely defined. That's why sometimes Qigong and Neigong are interchangeable. But Usually, people use the term 气功 instead of 内功 to describe a style of practice. Generally speaking, 内功 implies a result, while 气功 implies a process. Finally, let's talk about 导引. Well, 导引 is just another name for 气功. There are many names for the term 气功, such as 吐纳、玄功、养生功, and so on. So, my suggestion to you as well as the entire community is to standardize upon one word, 气功, and remember other terms like 导引 as synonymous of 气功. I think our community could use some serious standardization and we can and should work on this process whenever possible. You also asked me about the differences between these terms in the Daoist versus Shaolin context. Well, I'm not qualified to answer from the Shaolin side since I have not trained in the Shaolin styles, even though I personally know some Shaolin martial monks. Knowing and talking to some expert of a style does not automatically give me any authority to comment on that style. However, speaking from the Daoist context, as well as my general knowledge and experience of energy practice, I think the terms 气功 and 内功 should mean the same in all the practice as in Daoist since they are used to express and describe the same concepts. Of course, the term 气 is the Daoist concept, but it has already been adapted by many Shaolin practice now. I do recommend you check with a Shaolin expert to get a comprehensive picture if you are still curious. I hope that answers your question. Ernesto, let's move on to the next question. WahrerDrache, sorry if I'm butchering your name, asks, my question would be about the Xing Yi five elements. Are there any combination drills except the different variation of Pi, Zuan, Beng, Pao, Heng, and so on? And if not, how useful would it be to work on useful combinations? Or should one rather work more on 12 animals? Thank you. This is a good question. There are many different drills in Xing Yi and practicing any combination of different drills can have a great benefit on your practice. However, since Xing Yi as a style is largely based on the five elements, which represent five types of powers. Therefore, any single drill or combination of drills can be broken down into five elements type of power, which can be different from the standard five elements. 12 animals are 12 sets of techniques based on five elements or five type of powers. So, five elements is the key to power, while 12 animals is the key to technique. It is important to distinguish between power and technique training in Xing Yi, which I have emphasized many times in prior videos. Furthermore, for your daily practice, five elements is the priority and you do not have to practice all of the 12 animal set at the same time. In other words, you can choose one or two of the 12 set of practice and work on them beside five element practice. Again, Xing Yi is famous for its martial power, and any techniques coming from a practice of 12 animal and other routines should be built upon the five type of power. In Xing Yi, there is a famous proverb, 五行为体，十二行为用。Translation, five elements practice is the body and the 12 animals is the application. 体 or body means the essence, foundation or fundamental. WahrerDrache, I hope I have answered your question. Let's move on to the next question. Mr. Thomas Hudecsek asks, When you meet someone who is clearly wrong in his understanding of the martial art and its background, but at the same time believes very strongly in his knowledge, maybe he even says you are wrong, how do you react? Do you ignore it, discuss with him, or do you try to correct his view? Hello, Mr. Hudecsek. First of all, thank you for your great question. First, I'd like to share an experience with you. About 10 years ago, I visited my wife's hometown in Shandong province. One evening, I was walking with her on the street and noticed a young man practicing Xing Yi in a park. Since we had a lot of time to kill that evening, I observed his practice for a few minutes and admired his serious attitude to training. However, I also noticed his practice had a lot of mistakes. Out of compulsion as a teacher, I walked toward him and started a conversation with him, during which I very politely pointed out a couple of mistakes that he should pay attention to. Well, I don't mean to brag, but many people in China would happily pay me a fee to point out their mistakes in practice. But instead of appreciating my free advice, this young man was very upset and said that I did not understand his practice and that his practice was authentic Xing Yi. Right away, I realized my mistake. I asked myself, why did I voluntarily point out other people's mistakes? Especially to a person who does not even know how to distinguish between right and wrong. So I was wrong and I made a mistake. Fortunately, I did not tell him my name, otherwise it would have been a very awkward situation. Since that incident, I have changed the way I communicate with others even when someone asks me about their practice. Unless they are my students or they are really looking for honest feedback, I will not say anything which can create any potential misunderstanding. This is how I deal with individuals. However, I never avoid honest and constructive discussion in the public. I will always share my understanding with the community at a collective level in a straightforward manner. I do not chase popularity by avoiding the truth, even though sometimes it may hurt some people's feelings. The reason is very simple. In dealing with individuals, very often it can get to a personal level and most likely honest and unfiltered communication will only make the situation counterproductive. So, for a few years now, I have drastically changed my approach. Now, if someone attacks me on a personal level, I resort to rumor mongering or misrepresenting my practice. I will most likely just ignore them. Like I said in the 99th video, I strongly believe the community as a whole can judge for themselves, both in terms of quality as well as intentions. At the same time, if it is necessary to clarify a topic that is commonly misunderstood in the community, then I will speak the truth regardless of the consequences, since I believe the truth has to be spoken out and eventually the community will be the judge. So, to answer your question, if I encounter someone who is obviously wrong in his opinions or practice, I will not correct that individual without seeing their own willingness to understand and accept new information. And like I mentioned before, I wasn't always like this, but this is who I am now. While it is difficult to convince someone in person, it is even more difficult to convince someone on the internet, and most often it is just not worth your time and energy. And I'm sure most of you may agree. A lot of people on the internet do not actually care about the truth, but only care about winning the argument. Their arguments never end. With even a little online and offline experience in life, it is very easy to tell the difference between a personal attack and open communication. If someone just criticizes you without first trying to communicate with you, then it is obvious that the person has a different agenda, and the discussion in the public will not solve any issue. So, I think ignoring that person is a better solution. Again, I focus on the practice and the community, not the individual. That is just my approach, and I understand other people may have their own approaches. Ms. Hudecsek, I hope my answer is helpful to you. Thank you once again for asking this question. Now, let's look at the final set of questions for today. Eric Potter asks three questions. Will he use some hostile language toward other people in the community, which I neither approve or nor condone? His actual questions are still worth of being answered, so I will only read his actual question and replace hostile language with neutral words whenever necessary. His three questions are: First, someone claimed your interpretation of Zhou Bu Li Lei was incorrect and that the proverb you mentioned was not the complete proverb. They claim the complete proverb to be Liang Zhou Bu Li Lei, Liang Shou Bu Li Xin, Yu Xin Er Qi, Yu Kou Er Luo, Kou Shi Dong Kou, Dan Tian Shi Hu, Chu Dong Ru Dong Jin Sui Shen, Chu Shou Wei Ying, Hui Shou Wei Xiong, Xiong Chu Dong Hu Li Wo, and so on. Could you please clarify this in a Q&A whenever possible? Second, according to an interview of some Xing Yi teacher on some YouTube channel, the name Xing Yi with a G didn't exist before 1925, and that YouTuber mentioned in a Facebook comment that Xing Yi with a G was called Xin Yi without a G up until the 1930s. That sounds really strange to me. I'm aware you said some time ago that you won't criticize other teachers, but could you please clarify this historical issue in your Q&A whenever possible? Third question. Someone else claimed that you pretty much ignored the term Jin Sui Shen in your Zhou Bu Li Lei video and said that this line appeared in both Xin Yi Quan Pu and Xing Yi Quan Pu. He said, Jin Sui Shen means tightly following the body. Could you please clarify these sentences in a Q&A? Well, Eric Potter, like I have mentioned already in Facebook comments, I do not want to get involved in any unnecessary arguments between you and others. I will only focus on the technical, linguistic, and historical parts of your questions without blaming anyone else. I understand you were only trying to speak in support of me, but I still do not condone your derogatory language used to address others in the community. Engaging in discussion is great, but you should also pay attention to your style of communication. Regardless, I still appreciate your help toward the community in terms of getting key issues answered. I hope you understand and support my advice. So, you asked three questions, each involving a claim from others, and my short answer is, all three claims are wrong. Now, let me explain one by one. Your first question is about a version of the proverb Zhou Bu Li Lei that even longer than the five-sentence proverb I mentioned in a prior video. Well, the reference that I used was the original or the oldest version of that book. which is at least 270 years old, and it's possible that it could be even older than 400 years. Please watch my video titled Decoding Martial Proverbs 11, 肘部离类. Link is in the description. However, the sentences provided by the other person were from a training manual written and edited by Wang Hong, a Xing Yi teacher who practiced both the Shanxi and Hebei styles of Xing Yi and passed away in 1979. He extended the original proverb by adding a few sentences in his own document. Regardless, it does not clearly convey the meaning of that proverb. So, Wang Hong's proverb is not the original one. It's simply his own writing that used some of his sentences from the original. Again, methodology is very important in doing research. You have to use the right document, preferably trace the proverb or concept to its oldest possible source. If you can only find the term in some new written work, but you believe it to be the original one, then that is a mistake, both in methodology and the final conclusion. By the way, in order to ensure the rigor of my research before posting my video on 肘部离类, I also consulted Mr. Cui Hu Gang, a great expert and scholar in martial art document collection and research. Mr. Cui Hu Gang has collected a huge amount of martial training manuals, including this book, Xing Yi Quan Quan Pu. Now, let's talk about your second question about someone claiming Xing Yi with the G was known as Xing Yi without the G until the 1930s. Xing Yi as the name of the style has been used much earlier than the 1930s. For example, Liu Dianchen and Sun Lutang both published books and used Xing Yi as the book's title earlier than the 1930s. Actually, Sun Lutang's book was first published in 1915. So, the claim that the term Xing Yi with the G was only coined in the 1930s is a mistake. I have no idea why some other people use mistake information as evidence in communication. I cannot answer that for you, but I can only clarify historical fact here. Finally, let's come to your third question about the interpretation of Jin Sui Shen. Jin Sui Shen is a proverb used in Xing Yi very often. You asked me whether the translation of Jin Sui Shen is tightly following the body or not. Well, I have to tell you that this translation is not correct. The word Jin has many meanings in Chinese language. This character can be used as the noun, a verb, an adjective, an adverb, and so on. However, if we look at the sentences 出动入动紧随身, the character 紧 is in front of the verb 随. So, 紧 in this case is not an adjective. It is actually an adverb, specifically meaning quickly or well. The accurate translation of the term 紧随身 is quickly follow the body. Let me state it again. Tightly following the body is an incorrect translation. The accurate translation is quickly follow the body. In English, you can very often convert an adjective to an adverb by appending an ly to the word. For example, appending ly to the adjective malicious converts it to the adverb maliciously. But this is not the case in Chinese language. The Chinese language is not like English in that you can just append something to the word since each Chinese character is independent and cannot add anything when converted from an adjective to an adverb. So, Jin means tight when it is used as an adjective or verb, but it cannot be translated to word tightly because it is an adverb in this sentence. It is a linguistic mistake, and even many Chinese people do not know this. Fortunately, I have studied classical Chinese very well. Also, my wife has a master's degree in Chinese literature, among other degrees. She worked as an editor and a journalist in Renminjibao or People's Daily, the largest newspaper group in China before moving to Canada. So, I'm a Chinese linguistic expert married to another Chinese linguistic expert. We may argue on many things like any other couple, but in case of this linguistic issue, we are both in agreement. Again, the misinterpretation of the term by the other person is a linguistic and a cultural mistake due to their limited exposure to the Chinese language. Of course, it's natural and expected that a lot of people will make such a mistake. But fortunately, I'm in a position to correct this mistake. Eric Potter, I hope I have answered all three of your questions. I love reading all the comments since they help me figure out the common mistakes and misunderstandings in the martial art community, which I can answer in my videos. No matter what language or tone, I will try to filter out topics and issues useful for the community. So, all the comments are good comments to me. Those were all the questions for today. Before concluding today's video, I would like to express my deepest gratitude to the entire community for your feedback, questions, and comments throughout the entire video series. It's impossible to credit each and every one of you by name in a short time, but let me individually thank a few of the regular participants: Mr. Thomas Hudecsek, X Wu Navarro, Frederick Godin, Frederick Leclerc, Brandon Redmond, One Direction, Sebastian Constantin, Ernesto Pong, and Pepperdan. I sincerely apologize if I forgot any names. A quick reminder, please let me know any comments, concerns, and ideas you may have, neither about the not-profit organization or the three-level practice system I introduced, or both. That brings us to the end of today's video. Thanks for watching, see you next time, and enjoy your practice.